Afternoon. Once again, I'm very happy to be with all of you for this afternoon to share with you some precious Buddha Dharma. Not just any Dharma, but Buddha Dharma. So, if I'm correct, today the topic is about cause and effect, isn't it? So, which I think stemmed from the lung of, or the oral transmission of the four foundations, or the preliminary practice, or Hondro as it is known in Tibetan. So, cause and effect. In short, I think it's the thing that we always talk about, or that we always hear. That we know, that we have heard over, I think, quite a while, probably over now, close to 40 years maybe, around the world. Before, I think it was more in the conversations within the Asian continents and within its vicinity, the topic of karma. But now, every now and then, it's there in everyone's conversation, as a joke, as a conversation piece, mostly as a sort of a conversation piece. Yeah, but it's good. It's good in every way. And that's although we are talking about karma every now and again, whenever we have a conversation among family or friends or acquaintances or strangers, we are always talking about that, but somehow we haven't a name for it. And now, due to the full flourishment of Buddhism around the world, now we have a name for it, which is karma then. But of course, the way we interpret that, understand it, it's probably frowned upon by my great masters, maybe, in terms of how we look at it or how we interpret it. So, probably that's why we are all here, you know, to understand its mechanism and everything. So, yes, in English, I think the best term that we have is cause and effect. Or in between, we can add one more conditions. So we have, we are able to summarize the topic of karma in 3 points: cause, conditions, and effect. Yeah. And it's a very helpful subject. Those are very helpful points for us, whether we are practitioners or not. So that's the topic. So now the point is, or point for me, is to see how I should present it today for all of you, so that we can have it as a, again, as usual, as a conversation piece. In short, to give away the punchline, let's say, is that without some idea of the famous word emptiness, there is no way of talking about karma or cause and effect. Without it, then it becomes very, very mundane and very short-lived in terms of its philosophy and everything. So, yeah, in the end, its basis, or the very idea of karma, comes from understanding, or Very simply, it is based on emptiness, or selflessness. Now, for us as beginners, particularly learning the ways of the Hundo, or the preliminary practice, it is very important because then it is a motivator or a drive for us to push ourselves towards a virtuous path. Otherwise, the very things we do in life seems meaningless after a while, no matter how exciting it is in the beginning, be it profession or let's say passion or anything, becomes pointless. And so with the understanding of these four thoughts, now in today, particularly with the cause and effect, it truly helps us to really motivate ourselves that we must watch out in what we do, in what we say, in what we think. I think in terms of what we do, I think, and what we say, I think we all have sort of like awareness that of its effects, positive as well as negative. So therefore, we are as long as we are conscious, I think we are how do I say, pretty well equipped in terms of what is what. But the main thing is the seed where it grows from, meaning mentally, in terms of what we think. And there, of course, like since we cannot read each other's thoughts, of course, it's there is sort of there's a sort of a space or a circumstance that makes us feel that probably there is, it's safe, and maybe it's innocent to some extent to venture into various kinds of thoughts. So probably that's a point that we have to maybe focus on and be aware of. So meaning not really to go very deep into it in terms of being very technical and things like that, to make ourselves very restricted and troubling for ourselves, but in terms of attitude, you know, as long as we have a positive and a courageous attitude, naturally we don't have to worry ourselves of what we think. And as simple as that, I think. So, in terms of attitude, the best that I could think of is that of the Bodhisattva's attitude. If we can gain, or if we can develop, as I've said in these last few days, if we can imitate or mimic the ways of the Bodhisattvas in terms of how they approach towards things, particularly in their thoughts, then naturally, it's a wonderful start, and from there onwards till the end, it's a very good middle, you know, a good continuation. So that's why, if you can develop a courageous attitude, although knowing that our existence is fragile, although knowing the dangers of the mundane activities, still to have a very, one could say, optimistic, you know, to have a great deal of optimism about life. Not to the extent that we become careless, but in terms of knowing that every method, every means that we apply are there not to make it difficult for ourselves, but they are there to actually make things easier for us so that we have abundance of means to overcome various difficulties. So I think that's a better way of presenting the, that's one way of presenting the cause and effect. Now, in terms of the cause and effect itself, we all, the moment we think about it, it becomes very linear, you know? Meaning that, well, in a way it's good, but in terms of, how to say, like, that's, for example, there is every truth that when something happens, we tell ourselves that, oh, that is karma. It helps us to react to that experience better, maybe. But after some time, although we keep saying that, both to ourselves and to others, sometimes we'll be just sort of repeating that and not really knowing what it means, you know. So, and that's why we have to, from time to time, particularly now with the practice of the Four Foundations, we have to remind ourselves that it's just another means, it's just another word that we tell ourselves over and over again to indicate towards something. Something that we are not so comfortable with, you know. That's why the punchline comes back, that the idea of emptiness. Yeah. That when we say that, oh, something happened, some tragic that has taken place in one's life or a friend's life, and something, we say that, don't worry, it's karma, you know, try to accept it that way. It helps to some extent, but not all the way, I think. Sometimes if you just hear that and nothing more about it, or if you have not much of an understanding of what it is, sometimes we could sort of make ourselves less courageous, you know, more doubtful of what we do, and feel somehow the idea of guilt comes along, yeah, because of that. So that's why it's important that it is just sort of a mild and a term that we can relate in our daily lives. And at the same time, actually sort of passively indicate towards emptiness, you know. So, well, in a gist, I think that's the point. Meaning that now, if something happened, we take it so seriously that, of course, like it's when problems occur, it happens right on one's face. Yes, so therefore we are completely overwhelmed. We are taken by it and not know how to deal with it. So, in other words, maybe a friend could say, just don't worry, or everything will be all right. That's another way. And another way of saying, in this context, is saying, oh, don't worry, it's karma, but probably doesn't sound too good. So that's why, should we hear that word from one's friends, I think it is our sort of responsibility, and it is our sort of duty, no, but definitely responsibility to have the courage to understand that as something very, very actually in one word, giving one of the best advices, you know, and meaning that it means that actually how do I say it? It might not even sound nice if I say it's relative, you know. So basically, it connects to the idea of emptiness, meaning that It's happening because within a fabrication, a fabricated world, fabricated condition, things happen. And according to whatever cause we have accumulated or planted, accordingly it happens, yes? And because the very base is unborn, the very base is selfless. So that's why it has the space to give its effect, and that's why we can also experience it if our mind is within that setup, within that boundary, you know, within that within its law, let's say. So, yeah, bottom line, and that is it. So, now if you go more towards a traditional sort of approach in terms of the cause and effect, we can very simply go towards the 10 virtues and its opposite, 10 non-virtues, meaning physically or vocally or through speech, and then mentally we accumulate according merits. Yeah. So of course these three doors, as it is known, through these once we are within that system of utilizing these three doors to channel our thoughts, or let's say, channel our consciousness to experience the reality as we know, then naturally there is countless possibilities to accumulate what is known as meritorious, non-meritorious, or demeritorious, and in between. So, accordingly, then we accumulate countless of karma, countless of causes. Let's say countless of causes. Yes. According to the virtues, then the various levels of realms, or various types of realms, are generated. Yeah. Of course, like within the text, we talk about 6 different realms, or according to the Gampopa tradition, 5 realms, and so on. Of course, they are not all set on stone, or sort of forever defined like that. It's really according to our own actions and thoughts that will define, or that will result into whatever experiences we will have later on. So naturally then we can think of the higher realms, or the joyful realms, as well as the lower realms accordingly. So what we experience right now is known as the human existence. Well, we can experience almost anything, from the highest joy to the most bitterest, let's say, of experiences of sadness or pain. In a way, it's extremely precious. From my own personal interpretation, I would say it's to some extent, one could say, even beautiful, you know. And that we can think about the higher realms, you know, higher than human realms, and they experience great, let's say, luxuries of time and luxuries of enjoyment and so on. But nevertheless, they will never be able to experience what we experience, in a way. Constantly we are challenged by its fragility. And so, therefore, it makes it truly worthwhile and that much more meaningful. And because of its fragility, then we can actually focus on karma. We can actually focus on what would come next, depending on what I do right now, or depending on what we do right now. Whereas within the higher realms, no matter how much of a time we have or they have, that condition is not there. Yeah. There is almost no reason to think about it. As it is explained in the Abhidhamma, the only time that they are able to think about the next life or the effect of what they have done or of the effect of the life is within the last few days for some. Some don't even realize, and then they're faced with next rebirth all of a sudden. Whereas we ourselves, we have in this case, from the moment we are conscious, from the moment we can think intellectually or have some kind of form of philosophy about life, we're able to reflect and see what could happen, you know, depending on my own action. And that's what's precious, I think. And that's what makes it precious because, as I said earlier, beautiful, because due to it, we're able to develop respect for ourselves. Just for the fact that we are born as human beings, we can respect ourselves. We can respect what we have accumulated in the past, the difficulties we have gone through to gain this rebirth. So, yeah. So now I have more or less opened a door for quite a number of questions. So should you wish, you can start to have some questions concerning cause and effect, nothing else, no politics. About food, it's fine.